I'm really excited to do this, Pop. I appreciate you sitting down. I know there are a ton of people that just love hearing your stories and your wisdom. So when we told everybody we were going to do this, there was so much excitement around this. So thank you for agreeing.
I hope I live up to their expectations, but yeah. I don't know what to expect.
Yeah, that's a challenge in life, right? Living up to other people's expectations.
I should warn you that if you ask me anything embarrassing or things that I can't answer, I could change my will. So your inheritance might depend on what you say. I just want to give you that warning.
Yeah, I discussed that with Brian. So
yeah, okay.
Fully understood. No, I appreciate that. So there's so much stuff that I want to ask you and cover and that other people have asked me to ask you. But I thought maybe we'd just start way back from the beginning because I would really love to ask you about your dad, Hyman, and really just kind of go through your whole journey starting from there. So tell me about, like, what was Hyman like?
Well, before that, my dad was an immigrant from Latvia. At that time, it was Russia. My mom was from Poland. My dad lived through the First World War, and he was in St. Petersburg when the Russian Revolution was going on. And he came here in the early 20s. He's a sheet metal man in Russia, so that's what he became here and became a contractor. Then after, and he made money every year, put it in a bank, had a lot of money, and the bank closed. He lost everything.
Oh my gosh.
He went bankrupt in like 1932, but when he made money, he paid everyone back, and he started Famous in 1933 because he knew as a contractor what other manufacturers and distributors didn't give him, and he wanted to give other people, such as training, having the parts in the middle of winter, service, etc. Mm-hmm. We grew up during the Depression, which is important. He started the company in the height of the Depression. No one did. And things were tough. My grandmother, my grandfather, an aunt and an uncle had to move in with us. They didn't have a place. And it was really fantastic. I had all these women taking care of me. It was just my father, my mother. I had an older brother, Don, who passed away many, many years ago. My sister, Gloria, who's 90 and still living. And myself. And my father was a man of very, very, very few words. Very. When he came to this country, he couldn't speak it, of course, though he spoke six languages in Europe. And he never learned how to write. The only thing he could write was his signature. But for some reason, he taught himself to read. He read every single night. That was before TV and everything. And he'd give stuff for me to read, and then he would question me if I understood it. He was as fair, honest, had the best memory of any person that ever lived in this world. He gave respect to everybody, from a truck driver, etc., and the respect was reciprocal. And as I went on through life and looked at many of our competitors, which I knew tons of, they did the exact opposite. The monies that they made, they invested other things, etc. My father was a man of very few wants, and he passed it on to me. I'm driving like an 8-year-old car. I don't have a place in any other city. I don't have any horses, boats, or airplanes, but I do have friends that have that, which is even cheaper. So, but my father taught me to be frugal. Whenever I'd want something, like I had one baseball mitt and I wanted a new one, my father would take the money out, put it on a mantle. He said, if a week from today you still want it, take the money. So I had one baseball mitt, one bicycle. And he taught me that material things don't last, but relationships with people. And I mean his vendors, his customers, as well as obviously family members and our associates. And that kind of sums up, and he taught me so much about business and management, you would have no idea.
Yeah.
Any rate.
Well, I was gonna ask that, because it seems like you two spend so much time together. Tell us about your relationship with Hyman. It almost kind of seems like, as I read through the book and hear the old stories, like, were you almost kind of like best friends in a sense?
Yeah. My father had very few hobbies of playing cards with his brother and not too much else. His religion, family, and Famous, the only things he really focused on. And my older brother passed away very, very young. I knew I was going to be in Famous from a little boy, stocking shelves and sweeping floors at 10, 12 years old, and I just kind of loved it. And since it was him and me and nobody else, we got very close. Like, years after college in the Air Force, and that I was an officer in the Air Force, we would visit branches on Sundays, him and me. We'd talk all the way there, all the way back, because in what I learned is that at work, we're both so busy doing things, we couldn't really talk. So being in the car with him, I would ask him questions, he would tell me, he'd give me constructive criticism, which he was always right. And it was a friendship that probably as strong as any father and son could ever have.
Yeah, and I think it's cool that, you know, I hear stories about you and my dad driving to work for many years together.
Yeah.
Me and Brian spent many, many car trips with my dad as well.
Uninterrupted trips in a car, and this means with an associate or customer or anything, the amount of transfer of communication of everything you feel, need, want, and question is very, very easy.
Mm-hmm. And it seems like, so when you say that he gave you a lot of feedback, it does sound like from a lot of the stories that he was pretty tough on you.
My dad was so forgiving and nice to all our associates. It was unbelievable. Not with me. If I'm at work and I did something, he says, "Jay, come in, shut the door." Oh my God. Then I knew what's going to happen next. He would tell me everything that I did wrong, quietly, one-on-one, that I would learn. Example, I'm in my middle 20s. The vice president of our biggest supplier, which is Luxair still today, Ed Hayes, the vice president, came in to talk to my dad. My dad asked him a total of, found out later, 10 questions. Man, I'm smart. I answered him. Ed left. Oh, and I called Ed Hayes Ed because my dad did. Ed left. Dad told me to shut the door. He said, at no time will you ever call him Ed. He's Sir or Mr. Hayes. You haven't earned the right to be that informal. He said, I asked 10 questions. 7 of which I knew the answer, but I wanted to see if I'm gonna get the right answer from him, honest. And the other 3 questions I didn't know, but if I trust him on the first 7. So you interrupted to be a big shot to show how much you knew. So you killed the whole thing. Next time, if I ask someone a question, just be quiet and just listen. And you learn more from listening than talking. And we all know that.
Yeah, and that's something that I think you've always been really good at, is asking questions and listening. I'm curious, when you talk about how when Hyman came over, he didn't know any English, do you think he almost kind of used that to his advantage to just kind of shut up and listen and learn and ask more questions?
Can't answer that. Don't know. But he worked so many hours a day, 12, 14 hours a day. you know, to make a living. Because after he came here a few years afterwards, he got married to mom, and he spent a lot of time working. However, if it came time for a family function, a religious holiday, or anything else, he knew how to separate business from that. As a matter of fact, in all the years we were together, as close as we were, we never really talked business ever at home. He wanted, when he comes home, to be with the family, to read, etc. So we didn't bring our problems from work home, which I've tried to do the same thing.
Mm-hmm. So one of the things that I'm curious about, you know, you talk about how you grew up in the business and, you know, you were sweeping floors from a very early age, and you said that you always knew that you wanted to, not that you wanted to, but you just knew that you were going to.
That was my future. I love my dad. I love what we're doing. I loved what vision he was telling me we're going to do. We're going to open up branches. What's a branch? I don't know. When we open it up, we'll see how it works. Yeah. I mean, so it was just fun. And in college, and even more so in the Air Force, I had so many learning experiences and great teaching at ROTC and in the Air Force. And it was all in my head, how do I direct it to Famous?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's what I wanted to ask. I mean, some people in your situation, they might not even go to high school, let alone go to college and go to the Air Force. They may say, you know what, I'm 15, 16 years old. I know what I want to be doing. I'm just going to start working. You didn't do that.
Well, let me tell you a story. At the age of 15, I started working at Famous. Down the street came John Callis. We started at the same time. We unloaded trucks in the morning. We loaded, we worked in the sheet metal shop. He had to quit school at 15 to support his single mother. Later, he did finish high school at night. And he was as brilliant as any man that worked for me. And my dad never, ever cared that much about a person's education. He cared about the culture, what he thought, things like that. And I learned that because some people in our industry want to hire people with all this expertise on a thing. And my father would hire someone because we could teach them how a furnace works.
So, you know, you go through the next couple decades, you guys are opening branches, you have all this growth, and then mid-70s, so you would have been about in your mid-40s, your dad passes away.
I was in my 30s.
Oh, you were in your 30s. Okay. Yeah. So, you know, what was that like going through that, and how did it change, you know, how you showed up to work and how you led the company forward?
Well, it's interesting. Up until my dad's last year of his life, he was in great health. The last year, he had a lot of health problems, times in the hospital, etc. So I had to automatically do what I did before, or what he did. And one day he said to me in the hospital, he said, Jay, move into my office. Dad, I can't move into your office. It's your desk, your office. You will move in there. So people will know you're the boss. And that's it. So I moved in there. So when he passed away, the support I got from our branch managers and the people was so overwhelming that it made it very, very easy to take over, much easier than people might think.
Yeah. Yeah. And so when you come into that role, you know, there's, you know, you're not with your dad anymore. Was it overwhelming for you where it's like, oh my God, I'm on my own now? You were sort of sidekicks with each other running the whole thing. What was that like?
Well, it was so extremely easy you wouldn't believe it, because my father never used the word collaboration, but that's what he did his whole life, and I did it. So it was seamless. We just continued doing. And at that time, you're so decentralized, you know. When I started out in life, we had a inkwell and a straight pen. And at work, we got number two pencils. And we got a typewriter, and later electric typewriter. But at any rate, it was very simple. So when we opened up a branch, we had to rely on the branch manager. They did their own buying. If they couldn't buy enough of something to get the right price and freight, they would call two other branches around them. They would pull orders. Once a month, we'd get together to buy big stuff together. So the people did so much of their own work. We didn't have a credit manager. They managed credit. We didn't have an HR department. Each branch manager was their own HR department. So because we're decentralized and we let people assume authority and responsibility, and my father was the opposite of a micromanager, I've had some of that problems in my life, that the people developed. Mm-hmm. And I learned that the more you let people on their own, so they make a mistake, okay, they don't do it. One time I remember I made a mistake. My dad called me in. I said, Dad, don't worry. I'll never make that mistake again. And he said to me, Jay, if a baby puts his finger in a flame in a candle, he burns it, he won't do it again. Your job is to learn from other people so you don't make the mistake the first time.
So those next couple decades for you and the company, it was like crazy growth, you know, branches, acquisitions. Obviously, the country continued to grow. What was that like those next couple decades? It must have been just constant activity.
Yes, it was an activity because I bought about 11 companies, including some branches we opened up, of course. But it was fun. When you're having fun, the old story is, if you're having fun at work, you're not really working. So the excitement of accomplishing something, and my goal in life was not material things. What I enjoyed the most was watching people that I work with grow. Like John Palermo, our VP of sales and branch operations. He started like 19 years old, working in the warehouse and the counter and everything, never went to college. And he's as good a sales manager and branch operations person that there is in the United States. So that's where I get my enjoyment, plus the fact of having family people like you and Brian. It's exciting for me that your offices are either side of my office. Mm-hmm. And I'm blessed with that.
Yeah. And your office still looks amazing with all of your tchotchkes in it.
Yeah, I'm a saver, a hoarder, yeah. Whatever you want to put.
What is it about, you know, the antique sales and the estate sales and the collecting? What is it about that is so much for you?
Well, I leave work Saturday, maybe 1 o'clock, Saturday afternoon. On the way home, I'd stop at an estate home sale. Love to see old homes, went in the basement to see the equipment, see the names on the plenums or boilers so I could call the customer about the job they did and how great it was. And
so you just wanted to get into people's houses.
Yeah, no, well, that was part of it, but I had an interest in antiques and paintings and books. And when I go to these, I picked up incredible artwork, I probably have now about 1,000 first editions of books. And it was fun, exciting, and I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Whether it's like an antique or even like buying a building at a great deal, what is it about kind of finding these diamonds in the rough that excites you?
That's a great question. Like finding buildings. Sometimes you find something that's an opportunity. We bought a branch in Sandusky, a plumbing branch. And right before we opened, an opportunity came up with a building in Fremont. Incredible, 4 acres, I forgot how many square feet at this time, for $16,000. It was an extra building that a lumber yard moved and had it. So we opened up in Fremont and Sandusky within a couple of months of each other. And by the way, they were 17 miles apart. And you would think that 17 miles apart, both couldn't survive. And both are thriving and growing even to this day, because it doesn't depend on the location. What it depends upon, the associates who work in that building, they would attract, retain, and grow their customers with them. So it was just fun. And fun, I love real estate and finding buildings and going up and down and finding out not what to buy, but maybe 9 out of 10 times what not to buy.
Yeah, yeah. Same thing like when it's hiring people, you say it's also about figuring out who to not hire, what building to not buy.
I spent hiring people, to me, was an experience. Because I'd meet them, then I'd have some of my key associates meet the person. And I'm talking a person, the warehouse counter man, and then I always, for sure, took the person to lunch and often took them to dinner. If you go to dinner, offer them a beer, and sometimes you learn more at dinner when they're relaxed than you do in a quick, formal interview in the daytime.
Yeah.
You can never spend too much time researching a person, because one bad person could screw up a whole organization. Mm-hmm. One bad apple can spoil the barrel. So we were, and my dad was, when my dad used to interview people for big jobs and they're working at another company, my dad interviewed them in our living room because my dad didn't want to be seen in that city at a restaurant and people would see him and he might get fired. So I can't tell you how many interviews of big people we had in our living room growing up. We had one great interview. My dad wanted to hire this guy. And the guy said he's making $80 a week. And my dad said, okay, we'll hire you at $75. The guy said, no, I got to go home with my wife. I'm not going to tell her I took a cut. My dad said, bring your wife in next week. Next week they came in and my dad talked about the vision and the opportunity, his wife said, to do it. That happened to be Bill Green, who worked in an office in a counter and this opened up Wheeling, West Virginia, then became a regional manager and was about the best person that anyone ever hired. And he didn't go to college either, but it was these evening interviews in our living room. And you know, I like to talk. But from the start, when they came in, I would say hello. When they left, I said goodbye. And I never said a word during the whole thing.
What were you looking for when you say we wanted to make sure we didn't bring on the wrong people? What are the things that if you heard that or sensed it, that the alarm bells would go off and say, no, no?
Well, my dad didn't know when he hired people if they're Catholic or Baptist or anything like that. Religion never came up, nor race. We probably had more African Americans working for us in Cleveland and other places, from Steubenville to this and that, than anyone else. But he looked for what we call today, and what your father has adopted and amplified, is our culture, the fundamentals. If the people have the right culture to be with other people, if they had empathy for other people, they're going to be a success. What you need is drive and empathy and hopefully some brains to go with it. And that's all you need. Mm-hmm. Everything else people will learn.
Yeah. You talk about culture, and I think it's so interesting how Hyman and the early founders really started the culture, as you say, without even knowing what they were doing. But at any point in time, did he or the people that he was working with or you and him say, hey, Famous is going to be, we're going to be a different type of company. We're not just going to be a company. We're going to be a great workplace. Was that decision consciously made by anyone early on? Or
no, it was made by my father and I absorbed it. And he did it so subtly that you really didn't understand what we were creating. Mm. until in the old days, we used to visit other distributors a lot more than they do today. We would know other distributors, and I could just feel it going into other places. You could see the owner walking by his people and don't even say hello or good morning. My dad, at the end of every day, would talk to the truck drivers came in. My dad always thanked them for what they did that day. And what did they see? And they'll say, well, this customer is now buying this water heater from so-and-so, because they're there, they see it, and they have relationships. And the truck drivers had such relationships that our West Side guy, Jimmy Bell, had 25 keys of his customers' places of business. So he didn't even bother going in the office, or he went before they opened and would unlock the door, put the stuff in and leave, which I don't think legally you could do today.
We still have many customers give us their keys and we go right in because they trust us.
Yes, trust. In fact, that word that you brought up is maybe the key word for any company or any family, trust. Our vendors trusted us, our customers trusted us, and our associates trusted us. And trust is a two-way street. The more you trust others, the more they trust you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's funny, we talk about the word trust a lot. My favorite definition of trust, it's actually a math equation, and it says that what trust is credibility, you know, do you know what you're talking about, plus reliability, do you do what you say you're gonna do,
yes,
plus vulnerability, are you open and honest, divided by self-centeredness. So going back to what you said, empathy, you could have all those things, but if it's all about you, then it diminishes your trust.
Well, you never gave me that before, but it's fantastic.
I'll send it to you in an email.
Okay.
Do you have an email? Do you know last year, Papa, how many emails do you think you sent last year?
Oh God, I have no idea.
You sent 10,000, most in the company. 10,000 emails. It's pretty good.
Well, I have to reply this help.
Do you think, what percentage of those do you think go to Palermo?
A lot, because he was the center of sales and operations. So I would send more to him than, let's say, a counterman in Uniontown. Mm-hmm. And in life, this is interesting. You spend time, more time with your better people so they can grow. There's some people that just wanna do what they're doing, which is great. We want people, we have truck drivers that work 40 years and retire and loved every day. But for people that had the ego drive or the pride in themselves to do more, you obviously communicate with them more. Mm-hmm. You say 10,000?
10,000.
I was sending emails last night at about 10, 11 o'clock. I don't know if you got
I thought some. You were going to say 4 in the morning.
Yeah. Yeah. That was interesting.
Yeah, and communications obviously evolved. You know, today it's the emails, but back then, I mean, you would do phone calls. You would come home from work and whatever PM, and you knew what time each manager put their kid to bed, had dinner with them, and you would call them. And you would have legal pads of notes, and so you hang up with this one, then now you know, okay, it's 8 p.m., I gotta call this
Bill
guy.
Green went to bed like 9 o'clock because he got up at 5. He opened the branch at 6. Other people, Dick Blaney in Newark, would stay up late, and he was almost late to work every day, 8:10, 8:05, but never early. So you have to know them. And sometimes it works both ways. Yesterday, I had to get an e-check. I haven't been going out much. And on the way back, I stopped
at
a great customer and who has 70 employees to meet the new lady purchasing agent I heard a lot about. And I came in, I said, I just want to meet you face to face. I heard about you. And she said this, and she gave us constructive criticism of what we should put in inventory. She says, oh, I gotta tell you, I love Stu Bennett. Brady Rubin is the best salesman I ever met. She loved Joe Era. She said, you have the best associates in all of Cleveland, and she worked for many years for a major wholesaler competing against her. And she was telling me all this stuff and trust and this. She said, now, I work for this family company. I'm moving to Chicago in a couple of days because my husband was transferred there at his company. But these people still let me do 100% of the purchasing for a 70-person company, contractor. But that's working for a family that cares about me. And I got to tell you, even though I'll be in Chicago, I will be working with your people and try to give you as much business as I can because we trust you. And the word trust came up. When I left there to go home, I felt pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the other thing, when you say that, it makes me think of is how long it takes to build up trust, but also how instantly it can be just dumped
out. You can build a relationship, like let's talk about a customer, over a period of 10 years. But you could have the wrong salesman or the wrong person that could destroy it all in 1 minute. Saying the wrong things, doing something, upsetting the person, unfair criticism, fighting when the hardest thing I had to learn growing up, I would argue with customers in the beginning. You know, they're buying this water heater, I tell them mine's better. They say, no, theirs is better. And I would argue. And my dad had a right-hand man, John Petrie, would come up to me and say, Jay, you know, you just insulted that plumber. Why? Because when you told him that his wasn't good enough, you insulted his intelligence. Quit arguing with these people. Just nod, knowing that they're going to think, and you're not going to change it. So these are all these lessons you learn through the years. Mm-hmm. But trust and loyalty goes both ways. Mm-hmm. The woman that I saw yesterday said, I got in trouble, and your people in Sebring are amazing. They helped me out. I didn't even know she knew we had a place in Sebring, etc. But that when they trust you, that's the foundation, both as a family and as a company, to succeed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you clearly, you know, again, a lot of people, I don't think, take the time or make it a focus to build relationships, which is really, I think it's sometimes counterintuitive. They think they don't have the time to build relationships because there's so much work to be done, when maybe they don't realize that if they built the relationships, the work would get done as a result of the great relationships.
You said it perfectly. You said it perfectly. And the other situation is you don't want to hire people, and you kind of used this before, that are so self-centered on themselves that they really don't care about the other people. You have to care, but go more deeper, have empathy to be successful in anything, including your personal life.
Yeah, and it's funny you say that because it's like the smallest thing in the world. It's like if you just cared about other people, but genuinely care, not faking it or saying, oh, if it'll help me grow the business if I just care about people, but genuinely caring about people, how it just unlocks so much to not just business, but life in general.
Yeah, actually, my dad used to use this expression, put yourself in their shoes. Before we had a major, any big meeting with the vendor, my father said, Jay, what do you think they want? And then I'll say something. He says, no, what do you think they really want? Maybe us to expand, to buy this part of their product line. We're not. What do you think? And it's like years ago, we had this gigantic meeting with Mullen Fawcett. My father had passed away. And wasn't going too good. We had a group of distributors trying to working for a buying group. So one of the people next to me said to Mullen, what do you really want? And they said, we don't care about the single handle business. We have that. But we came out with our two handle business, and that's what we'd like to focus on. So the guy sitting next to me who was doing a lot of the talking said, we will give 90% of our time to promote your two-handle faucet. So they gave us an incredible discount on both the single handle and that, because you can't assume you know what other people think. I hate when people generalize, well, this is what the customers think. Every customer is different. Some might want a cheap price. Some want higher quality. Some want incredible service. And you gotta listen to them and your people to see what they really are thinking, walking in their shoes. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned something, most people do not take the time to get asked the questions and listen.
And it almost seems like incredible how much time you personally have spent over the years getting to know people, whether it's associates in our company, customers, vendors, and even just others, like family members, friends, how much time you spend learning about people. And then, you know, you're at an estate sale, you see a book about, you know, birds, and you know that this person's wife likes to watch birds, so you get them the book and you send it to them with a note. I mean, there's thousands and thousands of examples of that. And people always wonder, like, how do you do it? How do you connect these dots?
By asking questions. I love going to a customer's office. You look around, you learn a lot about them. Oh, look at all these motorcycles. Yeah, my hobby is motorcycle. I got 5 Harleys. Another one has horses. Another one, so when you talk to them, you know, how are your horses, or how is this, or how is that? And because it shows you care about them, if it's genuine and you're honest. Mm-hmm. If you're not honest, people can detect that instantaneously.
When you say all that, the thought it triggers in me is going back to this theme of like being self-centered. I think you are so others-centered. You're so focused on others. Was it always like that? Did your dad teach you that?
Yeah.
Did it come naturally?
That is a great, great, great question. Is why when I watch my dad manage, today we call it servant leadership.
Yes.
When he would go to a branch, Lorraine, student, what do we need? How could we help you? What can we do? And you learn how to care what other people think and to help them. I've been a servant leadership my whole life. I'll sometimes back down. I'll be at a meeting. I'm listening to a manager or someone talk, and I'll never interrupt him, even though I know he made some mistakes, or a vendor. And I try to serve the people. What do we need? Some places, boy, could we get a, in the beginning, we didn't have forklift trucks. We had 9 branches with a total of 1 forklift truck. So as soon as the other branch managers found out this place had a forklift, we had to do it. But they said, we need a forklift truck. And that was pretty good. Or we needed powered tailgates, you know. So you listen and do help them perform better. And when you give them something that they asked for, they'll remember that forever. Because mm-hmm. many other owners of companies never ask their people what they want, never give them because they don't know. And then many of them just don't really care.
It seems almost like it's a habit that you can develop.
Yes.
Putting others first, considering others first, thinking about them, asking them, how are you, what do you need? It's like a habit.
That's a great, great statement. Because if you have good habits and you continue with good habits, it becomes so natural, mm-hmm. you don't even think about it.
It's funny you say that. It reminds me of something I heard recently. When you talk about habits and when we talk about our fundamentals, it's all about what we do. And there's like this quote where it's like, you know, we judge ourselves by our intentions and others by their actions. And it reminds me of something else that I heard recently. And it was that, you know, you hear this very often. They'll say, you know, deep down, they're a nice person. And I heard someone say recently, I don't believe in that at all. There's no such thing as deep down. You are a product of what you do. There's no, oh yeah, they do a lot of bad things, but deep down they're a really nice person. It's like, well, let's not give credit for being a good person deep down. Let's give credit for doing the right things.
Exactly. And that's what the other people that you react with remember, is your actions.
Exactly. Because they don't know
they don't care what you think in your head. They care about what they can see, feel, and know about you and your company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's amazing the quantity of relationships you've built, but also the quality. Most people don't get to the quality of relationships you've built with a fraction of the quantity. You know, one thing that is so funny that I just think is cool to have is your trademark $2 bills. Not a lot of people have many trademarks or signature things that's like, oh, that's them. When did that start? How did it start? And all?
I can't remember. I think I was someplace and I got a bunch. Can't remember where. So I gave them to some people for good luck. And I couldn't believe how much they liked it. So I give away a lot of $2 bills.
What's your annual spend on $2 bills?
It's out of my personal pocket. Many, many, many thousands of dollars. Yesterday I gave it
like
to customers.
4,000, 6,000.
God, I never want to know. it's in the many thousands because I get 2,000 of them at a time.
You get, okay, so you buy them in $4,000 increments.
Well, usually, I'm sorry, 1,000 I pay two, but sometimes more depending.
Stu Bennett was curious, what is your annual spend on $2 bills?
God, I'll have to think about that and tell you another. I don't even want to know.
Yeah. But it's, I mean, it's pretty amazing. It's a novelty. That's the word that comes to mind when I think of $2 bills, because like they're these things that they're not in print anymore, but they're still in certain, but it's a novelty. And I think that word novelty can also sum up a lot of the, just these little idiosyncrasies or things that you do for others, like whether it's the items in your office or things that you give away, they're novelties.
Yeah, and every one of us is different. Some people, like your father, has made the most incredible relationships on golf courses. I've talked to customers from Newark, Ohio, this they always bring up if they played with your father. I didn't even know they played with him. So he knows how to create personal deep relationships with vendors, customers, and our own associates in golf because he cares about people. He has empathy. He doesn't play with them because he beats them all. So it's not about the challenge, but it's because he cares. And that you're born with and you could develop it, but if you don't have it, you're going to be at a disadvantage of anything unless you work at a automobile agent factory and you're just putting on a tire all day long. Mm-hmm. You really don't have to have empathy to that car. You know, you must enjoy what you're doing, but it's not, we're in the relationship business. John Palermo says it every single day with his people, relationships.
Yeah. And it's, I think it's cool what you brought up, like using the golf course example. It's like integrating the idea of, you know, relationships, hobbies, family, work, and bringing it all together to have really full, rich relationships.
Yeah. So. Except for a couple times in the service where I try to go bird hunting, shoot a bird, never got one. Everyone has different wants. We got some people work for us that all they do is want to fish. Others just want to hunt. Others just want to bolt. Other just people still in a bunch of bowling leagues. So we're all different. And you can't, so if you have empathy and if you're lucky enough to do things with them, it's great. And many of our key people take their customers fishing a lot, can't believe how much, or something else.
Mm-hmm. And it's, again, where maybe some people look at those differences and it can be a way that differences can divide people or they can, you know, build bridges and bring people together. it seems like you're always so interested in what other people's hobbies are. Even if you're not someone that's going to hunt yourself, you're still interested in learning about it.
And when they tell me something, I go read it. I've got a book and read about some of this stuff. And what you just said is a lesson that should go in downtown Washington, D.C., where they need a little bit of what you talked about. I'm talking both sides, everybody listening. And
have you always been curious? So if somebody tells you about, you know, this hobby that they're doing and you never heard about it, so you go read a book on it, have you always been curious like that?
Yeah, curiosity is one of my hobbies. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing what I've learned. Some person raises bees. Then I read books on bees and how they're raised and hives and all this great stuff. You know, what we should do is hire more queen bees because they take care of everything. All the workers do the work for them.
Yeah. I want to talk about your hobbies because you, I feel like you quietly have a lot of hobbies because everybody knows that Famous is your foremost hobby. You love it so much. It's your work. It's your hobby. But you also have all these other hobbies. I mean, I guess we'll start with sports. I mean, you have always loved sports.
I played.
How many games have we gone to over the years?
Well, go back when I was a kid. No TV, no this. We're always outside playing football. No helmets, of course. Playing tackle football. Elementary school every day. Baseball.
You love horseback riding too.
Baseball. In my day, it was off fast pitch. Softball, which is a lot more fun than the slow pitch, though I've done that too. Went horseback riding as a kid. I went to a military camp at the age of 6 because my mom was sick and couldn't take care of me in the summertime, so I went to this 8-week camp. And at the camp, we shot rifles every week from the age of 6. And we went horseback riding, I forgot how many times a week. We played tennis. We played tons of baseball, mainly fast pitch softball, but we would get together an all-star team and would play a local town in hardball, even though we never practiced. And that was a lot of fun. And I was the worst basketball player that ever lived. I still can't dribble with my left hand, but I enjoyed it all. Of course, at my height, at 135 pounds, I couldn't make our high school football team, but my whole life I loved it. And then what I developed into was coaching. I've been around 29 of our teams, 29.
The Famous softball teams?
Yeah, well, with the kids when they started, they didn't have, starting at 6 years old, maybe 5 years old, playing softball all through high school. And then we had a group of kids that were fantastic that played like until they're 30 years old.
I mean, those teams, they went to national tournament. I mean, we could spend an hour talking about the Famous softball teams.
Yeah, one
How
time.
How did it start?
We had a softball team and we were pretty good. They're all kids from the neighborhood, from Beechwood. And we're in a tournament that we lost to another team. And I went to their manager and I said, I scouted the team you're going to play. Here's my notes. This guy always swings at the first pitch. This guy never does. This guy tries. So I gave him all these detailed notes. So that fall, I'm at home in the middle of winter and the guy calls me, John DeJulius. Mr. Blaushild, can I come over to see you? Yeah, sure. He says, I want us to put together a team. A really good team. So we had kids from Shaker, U.S., Orange, Beechwood, St. Joe, St. Ignatius, two from Walsh, and we had, I think, 11 shortstops, and he put the whole team together, and we started continuing on our Sunday morning league we're in. We won every game, sometimes 20-1. We were so good, it was unbelievable. We entered a national tournament and we ended up going to the Nationals representing Ohio. And I think we took 11th in the country.
Wow.
Yeah. We're the only team, I believed in having fun. We're the only team that every member took set of golf clubs, and I arranged for us to play golf.
That's funny.
Down there, instead of just some people were so obsessed with winning, you know, et cetera. So we had great, great fun, great experiences. Mm-hmm. Great. And yeah. I loved it when I watched these people.
And I think it's cool how, I think you said two things there, that you would bring your golf, the kids would bring their golf clubs down.
Everyone.
And you said the word experience that, and I think it could relate to any of the things that we've talked about, that it's more about the experience than it is the destination, right?
Yeah. Because baseball is a game you got to be kind of relaxed and loose. Mm-hmm. Football player, defensive line, you're there to kill somebody. So our kids, when we played, we beat, the first game we played, we beat a team that won 80 straight games. Wow. And were favored to win it. I didn't tell any of our players who were doing it. I figured, what are we going to do? We played the best game we ever played in our life. They played the worst. We beat them 8-7. We made the paper the next day that we beat this team. Mm-hmm. And our people didn't even know how good the team was we beat.
That's funny. One of my favorite coaching stories about you is when, and I don't know if it was Steve Wiseman or Jimmy Wiseman, but they were playing soccer, and the soccer coach couldn't coach anymore for whatever reason. And you decided to volunteer the coach to coach the team, but the only problem was you didn't know anything about soccer.
Jimmy, the youngest boy, played soccer before the other two kids, like Steve and Mark Wiseman, in high school, because we started a program. So this was like third grade. So the three people, I was in the stands, I don't know anything about soccer, and I just sit there, join the sun. So the three people ahead of me, Ernie and that, hey, we can't make next week's game, you're going to be the coach. I can't be the coach. So I had my wife at that time bring home from the library every book on soccer she could find. I stayed up till 2-3 o'clock reading these books. So this is a great story. So the next week we're going to play with Chagrin Falls. It was a Chagrin Falls. So I said to the guys, hey, last time we played them, what was the score? They all knew it. We lost 17-1. I said, well, if you listen to me, we're going to win. They looked at me like I'm crazy. I said, I read about how Italy beat England in 19-something by just playing defense, defense, defense. So no one's going to cross the midline. We're just going to play defense. They're going to get so frustrated because we're guarding our goal. They couldn't score. Had our whole team guarding the goal. They're going to come up, and then Levy is the fastest guy in the team. We'll kick it to him, and he'll score. We beat that other team 2-1.
That's amazing.
Oh, and so next week, my friend said, you're going to coach a team. I said, no, I just retired. I'm never going to have another game like that in my life.
You go out on a high note. You can't really top that, right?
Yeah, no, I didn't. That was my greatest coaching experience.
Yeah, yeah. The other hobby that I think maybe a lot of people don't really know about, it's funny, we've been talking about it over email a lot lately, is dogs. Some of these dog stories are unbelievable.
We had a dog, my first dog, that was before I went to kindergarten, was a fox terrier. And our whole life we had dogs. I grew up with dogs. I had dogs at college, you know, which almost no one did.
Yeah.
I had dogs in the Air Force, which almost no one did. When I married your grandmother Sue, one day I went out to a field trial just to see it. I ended up buying a Duke or Weimaraner, and I came home and I said, Sue, guess what? What? We now have a dog. You know, so.
Was she okay with that, or was she upset about it?
Yeah, no, she was fine. She was fine because the dog was so smart and so good. We put in a dog door, so if it ever needed a make, it went out by himself and came in. So if we're out late at night, we didn't have to worry about running home and the dog was so incredible. But dogs were part of my life. Other sports, I was an incredibly good, I gotta say that, tennis player and racquetball player that I played until all my friends I played with either died or shoulders wouldn't work. And I realized that it wasn't the tennis I liked or the racquetball that I liked that much, but it was the people that I was playing with mm-hmm. that made it good.
Yeah, it always comes back to this theme of human connection for you.
Yeah. And as far as hobbies, when I was in freshman in college, I had a friend of mine that I met, and he would invite me to this airport, Brown's Airport, to fly airplanes.
Oh,
and he
fly?
Taught me, yeah. So that. He taught me my first two airplanes was a Piper Cub with a 70 horsepower motor that was plane was so slow, and then a biplane, a Stearman biplane. And then I found out he didn't even have a license. And he's teaching me.
He's teaching you how to fly?
Pardon?
He's teaching you how to fly?
Yeah, he taught me. So at any rate, through life, I couldn't fly in the Air Force because of my eyes. I found friends who had airplanes. Would fly to Florida, would fly to Chicago, where I had friends that had boats. It's a lot cheaper to have a friend. I love boating, and I love everything about it. I love scuba diving. That was cheap. But if you have friends that have these hobbies, you go with them.
Yeah.
All my boating friends, I did pay for the fuel when we went out.
It's a nice thing to do. I want to go back to dogs for a moment because I think your story with Duke about how that connects with Famous Telephone Supply, I think is one of the most incredible stories.
So I had this dog. I got him at 6 months old. And I thought he was the most beautiful Weimer I ever saw. And I've had a couple before that. In college, in the Air Force, I had one different. But I thought he was beautiful. So I called up this trainer in Cleveland and said, I have a dog. He said, I have too many dogs. He had 17 that he takes to dog shows. I don't want another dog. I don't want to see it. Forget it. Find someone else. But I heard he's the best. So one day I showed up at his house with Duke. This is my dog. So he had to let me in. Beautiful wife, too. He looked at it. Did he says, you know, you really do have a good dog. So we took the dog. And 1 year he led the nation in best of breeds.
Duke did.
We took him to Westminster twice. We lost because there were other dogs and et cetera. And Duke was an incredible dog, and we had fun together, you know, and he was good. Like, I told the story, your father, when he was like, before even kindergarten, he loved going in the woods. Where we lived, we had acres and acres of woods. So he'd walk in the woods and the dog would go with him. Can't tell you how many times your grandmother called me, Jay, you got to come home. We lost Mark again. And we had the Pepper Pike police, sometimes firemen trying to find him. But he and Duke always came home.
And they were just going out for a walk.
Yeah. He was there for hours. Yeah. Hours.
But I want to go back to the Famous telephone story.
Oh, so my, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
So my trainer actually worked for AT&T, Ohio Bell. And he retired from Ohio Bell. So he would know certain things we sell. So he says, Jay, when I go to some of these places, could I sell some of your stuff? I said, what are you talking about? And he started with drill screws and flashlight batteries.
He
went to Cincinnati Bell. And every month they would buy pallets of flashlight batteries and flashlights and screws, which must take care of everyone in Cincinnati. But then he learned more what we had, and he was in the telephone business his whole life. He knew how to fix stuff. He used to work for bookies and set up a thing where they could find out how races went all over the world, all of the United States, and then their people, that wasn't him, but the people he worked for then would bet on the races because they know who's gonna win. So he really knew telephone. So later I said, why don't we start a little telephone company? We started with him and one person, and it developed, and then your dad took it over and built it up to about a $20 million company. starting from a guide to care of my dogs, until we realized at one time it's not our core business, and I needed your father at Famous Supply, mm-hmm. not Famous Telephone. Yeah. But he learned so much at Famous Telephone about managing.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah. How many years did he work there for?
God, I can't remember. But at that time he lived in Beechwood in the beginning, that's where I lived. And I'd pick him up and would drive to work and come home at night. And he would ask me more questions. And was so much involved in trying to improve himself and the company, it was amazing. He could absorb knowledge, etc. And we didn't always agree, but he listened and asked and developed. And he did everything at Famous Telephone. He was credit manager there. And one day he said to me, "Dad, I think I'm too hard on credit." I said, "No, just be hard. You know, we need the money." But he did every single job there, which when he went to Famous Supply, it all worked. Because mm-hmm. management is the same no matter what.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it sounds like that Famous Telephone really prepared him then to come into Famous Supply.
And yes.
So when he comes in, did you pretty much know at that point that, hey, he's going to sort of be my right-hand person and help me run the company?
Well, in the beginning, he wasn't my right hand. He grew into it. And I knew he was going to run Famous, period, because his love and desire and the buying, the selling, relationships, he just jumped in like I did with my father. So I knew he was going to be successful because he had everything, including the brains to do it.
Mm-hmm. When did you realize that he was ready to come into that role? And was it difficult for you to let go of that?
Yeah, we were at an annual trip with our customers. And I went up to talk. I think it was like 2006. And I said, "Oh, I have an announcement. Mark Blaushild is now president of the company."
But he didn't know.
Oh, God.
He didn't even know it was coming.
He was in a state of shock.
Why did you decide to do it like that?
Because I knew, I've seen too many people get so old and die without succession planning. And to have true succession planning, you want someone to do it, and you're still there mm-hmm. to advise them, "Hey, why don't we do this and this?" And your father was always so great asking for my opinion, "What do you think, et cetera." But I let him make 95% of the decisions. But
I mean, why did you surprise him like that? Why didn't you tell him beforehand?
I was down there, it's funny, at this trip, and the last night I have to give a speech, which I always did. And it just came to me, he's right. So I did it then. No one knew I was going to do it mm-hmm. except me. And it went out. Everyone there, I'll never forget it, they all stood up and gave a standing ovation. So, which confirmed I made the right decision. Because too many of my friends wait way, way, way too long before they give up their reins to another member of their family or some other valued employees.
What do you think makes it hard for those people that are not willing or afraid to let go? And what about this for you made it easier?
Because he had the respect of all our people. If you have the respect and the loyalty, when my dad died, one of our managers tried to put together a group of other managers to kick me out as president. It was crazy. Mm. And everyone he talked to called me. "All right, Tom, this is what so-and-so wants to do. So-and-so wants to do." So I saw he wasn't loyal to the company and himself, and I had a fire, and he was a good guy. But he wasn't collaborating and didn't respect me which I gave respect. I wanted it back because without respect, can't get things done. Mm-hmm. So
it's funny you describe, you say he was a good guy. Oh, a lot of people would think about that person and hold a grudge. You don't really hold grudges.
No. When he died later at the age of 97, I was at the funeral, eulogy and all that, and with his newest wife. And I'm thinking of all the great things that I said about him, which were true. But I missed him anyway. And we kept our relationship. The incredible thing was, after he left, we became closer than when he worked for me.
How do you do that?
I don't know. It was him. I think, well, he was an officer, fought in a war in the Second World War, and a pilot. And I don't think he understood other people as much as he should have, because years ago, when you're an officer, your word is a thing. No one questioned you. This is what we're going to do, etc. And in those days, what the boss said, everyone does. But it's funny, we both learned through the years, and I'd meet him in Columbus for lunch or dinner, and we never talked about me firing him, but he moved up in life, which I knew he would. So it worked out okay.
Yeah, that's interesting. So, you know, you sit here today, you're turning 88. You're still as involved, integrated in the company, really, you've ever been. You're attending and meetings every single day. What keeps you energized? And even though, as you've had, you know, health challenges over the last few years, every time we call you, say, I'm feeling amazing, I'm feeling great, and you're just so excited about our business. How are you staying so energetic and about our business and youthful physically and mentally?
Well, I can't go scuba diving. I can't play tennis anymore and this and that.
But besides those two things, it's insane.
Yeah. So the company energizes me. I love the business, you know, buying, selling, growing, but I love our people. So when I'm on these Zoom calls and I watch our people that I've known forever and our brand new associates that we brought on in the last couple of years, they are awesome. So when I get off a Zoom call, I'm saying, wow, was this one so fantastic and knowledgeable and just fit in. So it gives me such great pleasure. Mm-hmm. And then I write a bunch of emails afterwards.
Yeah. I always think it's so interesting how a sense of purpose can not only mentally but physically energize a person to the point where they're able to, and I think you embody that in a lot of ways. I want to ask, you know, and I don't know how many years ago, it might have been 20, might have been 15, you really made some big changes in your life with health. You started walking, you stopped smoking, eating healthier. Do you ever think back as you sit here today and go, oh my gosh, you know, can you imagine if you wouldn't have made those changes that you made?
Well, 38 years old, I mean, 38 years ago when I was 50, I had a heart attack and, you know, with a bunch of stuff. And it made me realize certain things. That's the day I quit smoking, the day I had my heart attack. And in life, you learn what you should do and what you should not do. Like I used to be a runner. I would work out at the YMCA, 6 o'clock in the morning, at lunchtime, and sometimes even in the evenings and every Saturday. So I loved working out, sweating, doing all that good stuff. But you mentioned the word purpose. I enjoyed the purpose of Famous and our people. And when you hire people that have the same purpose, to do one of our fundamentals, continuous improvement, that just makes me feel so great. It's not funny. Mm-hmm. I sometimes get off these calls and I'm the happiest guy in America.
Mm-hmm. Do you think, are you right now in your whole life, are you, you know, the happiest you've ever been, would you say that?
Yeah, well, the main reason I'm happy, I met Ruthie on a blind date, maybe I think 15, 17 years ago.
And you had come from a workout, right?
Didn't you? Yeah, I met her at a coffee. We were trying to get together for like 3-4 months. Either I'm busy or she was busy. So finally I called her up and I said, I know where you are. We're going to meet at this Barnes & Noble for a cup of coffee. Okay. And I came with a dirty, sweaty shirt, ugly pants, dirty shoes. And she was dressed up, you know, with high heels. She came from and really nice. And I didn't come across too well.
No. But she gave you a second shot.
Oh, she gave me, well, third, fourth shot. It took a little time. Mm-hmm. A lot of, well, you know, my magnetic personality finally won her over.
Of course.
But the last 15 years I've been with Ruthie is the happiest by far of any years I ever spent in my life.
Yeah, that's
traveling great. Together, doing things together. And when the pandemic hit, and I'm home all the time, especially till a couple weeks ago, we got closer and enjoyed every minute together.
Yeah, know? Some couples, they're spending all this time together and they realize, oh, maybe we
There have been problems. You read about divorces being up and this. And,
but you guys, it seems that you've really enjoyed spending a ton of time together.
Yeah, because we enjoy and appreciate the same things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, one of those things I want to hit on, one of your hobbies is music. I think you're interest in music, it goes very, very deep, but also very vast. You like all different types of music.
When I was in elementary school, our school used to have trips to the Cleveland Symphony once a year. And I learned classical music. I started playing clarinet when I was in third grade. I was pretty good too. And then saxophone. But I love playing, I love listening. And if someone say, what kind of music do you like? I like country. I like every type, but I'm not into rap too much, as you know.
But you like Kid Cudi and Drake. You like those guys.
Yeah, you've taught me how to listen. And some of the people you taught me to, and some of Brian's, aren't bad. But that's not my normal type of music. But music is a big part of my life. I can't live a day without music, and I miss the fact that I used to go to the symphony every week in Cleveland and in the summertime at Blossom, and I really miss it. There's one thing you mentioned before about hobbies. One of my favorite hobbies is traveling, and started it in the Air Force, going places, and then continued at Famous. So in about 1962, Famous had our first trip. We worked a deal with Honeywell. They gave us money. We had like 15 customers earned enough. They sold enough air cleaners to come. And through that, we had company trips every single year, which I went on, loved it, went to every place you could think of in the world. And then vendors would reward us with trips. Alcoa, Symington Windows, Luxair, Allied today. So I'd go on those trips too. And every year what kept me going and helped was going on trips. A, the family trips, I mean the Famous trips, I'd be with my customers and learn what we're doing right, what we're doing wrong, what we can improve upon. You know, I'd pick their brains when we're walking by the beach. And then with the industry trips, I would meet people from all over the country, other distributors. And you separate the successful ones with the others because you knew some were going to go out of business, and you learn from them what works. Mm-hmm. Because what works in Idaho, what works here, the principles of marketing, of management, the human relations is the same. So I learned a lot traveling, and that was a big hobby for me. And it was a learning experience, and I love being in different cultures.
If today the pandemic went away and you, Ruthie, could travel, although you're vaccinated now, you could travel, I guess, if you wanted to. if you could snap your fingers and travel anywhere in the world today, where would you guys go?
Well, that's interesting. Ruthie has her daughter and five grandchildren in Israel, and they have now all five of the grandchildren are married now. So every year, at least once or twice a year, I'd go to Israel, and their town they lived in is just a few miles, 10 minutes away from Jerusalem, and I'd go to Jerusalem. So that I have to have. Mm-hmm. Every time I go to Jerusalem, I get a chill up and down my back. Mm-hmm. But every you can mention a country. I mean, you gotta love Paris. You gotta love the southern part of France. You gotta love Spain, Italy. The Italians love us. I can't tell you how many times I've been to the Sistine Chapel. Mm-hmm. I'd go again if I could. Germany, and wherever you go, Czech Republic. Everyone says they have the best beer, and so you have to drink it. Been to Ireland like five times. As I think back of all the places I've been, Hawaii maybe 8 to 10 times, believe it or not.
Wow.
And so many companies have meetings there every year, and trips, etc. So I can't tell you which one. Probably because I'm a little older now, and probably be, and I love London. Oh my God. Probably be Paris. Okay. Paris is something unusual, and I hope you take Julie there one day.
Definitely. I want to touch on Israel, though. It seems like, and I could be wrong, it seems like over the last maybe 10, 20 years of your life, have you found yourself getting more religious and spiritual, or have you always really been devoted to religion, or has it sort of kind of ramped up over time?
When I was a kid, when I mentioned we lived in this house, and then grandma, grandfather, Aunt Seal, and Uncle Jack had to move in with us during the Depression, right down the street was our temple. 3-minute walk every day. It was the biggest conservative congregation in the country. And the building was called the Jewish Center. We had a swimming pool. We had boxing rings. I used to love to box. They had wrestling. They had basketball courts. And so I spent a lot of time there. Plus, we grew up in a very religious family, very religious. And I went through consecration, bar mitzvah, confirmation, everything. And it always affected me. And as I grew older, certain things you maybe not focus on, but focuses on you. And so I've always been, and I use the best word, spiritual. Mm-hmm. You know, but I never cared. I got friends and people work for us that are agnostic, that are atheist, that are this and that. And that never bothers me. And you can never have a lecture with someone, oh, you should be more spiritual or something. But it means a lot to me.
Mm-hmm. I think what's cool about it is, one, yes, how much it means to you, but your respect or even reverence for other religious traditions. If I had to guess, I would probably guess that you've been to church services, Buddhist services.
I've been
services,
to more
Muslim.
Weddings and funerals and everything. In fact, it's funny what I'm talking about, the temple that I went to when I was before kindergarten. It later we moved to the Heights, and it was sold to the Cory Methodist Church. And about 2 years ago, I went to their church service, mm-hmm. you know, seeing the same place I was on the Bema from Barbara. And I love, you know, I've been to every nationality, funerals and weddings you could think of.
Mm-hmm. So, were you gonna say something?
No, just reflecting back you know, about after the weddings, how the social thing afterwards, the drinking, the partying, the people you meet from their congregation, from Serbians, Croatians, Polish, they're all different, but yet they're all the same. Mm-hmm. Though some do drink more than others.
Yes. So as you look back, you know, 88 years, Famous, your life, it's kind of hard to almost separate the two, right? What sticks out to you the most as you look back?
As my what?
What sticks out as you think back on your life and your Famous journey? What sticks out the most?
You know, you used the perfect word that I'm going to share with you. The journey. I learned life is not a destination. You're on a journey every day as long as you're walking, as long as you're living. And to enjoy the journey. Does everything work out good? No. At Famous, we've had strikes, floods, buildings burned down. One time in a snowfall, we had buildings came down and both of our HCP manufacturing plants. But through it all, you know, that's part of life, and you've solved the issues at the time and you go on. So it's a purpose on the journey. Not only all the great stuff, but all the stuff that you have a problem with that you go on and overcome it. Mm-hmm. Our first branch was in Lorain, Ohio. We had three salesmen. One day on a Monday morning, we found out that a competitor hired all three of our salesmen. I'm ready to kill the guy because I knew him. And my dad says, no, it's a good thing he did it. I said, why is it a good thing? Well, because they left, it shows that they'll leave for more money. We'll find people to replace them that will be better, and watch how many of them want to come back, and we're not going to hire them. That's exactly what hire. But all of a sudden, you wake up, and in Mansfield, we had a competitor that one day stole all our truck drivers. And at that time, that was a big branch. And I'm ready to kill the other distributor. My dad says, no, we'll get ones, and they're going to end up better. And some of these, we had some good ones, we'll come back, which they did. So you have to remember to take a problem and enjoy fixing it and improving and go on. And that's a lesson my dad taught me, and we lived it.
Yeah, it's not about the cards you're dealt. That's kind of out of your control. It's about just making the best out of it.
Yeah, so it's the journey in life that I like, mm-hmm. The journey.
As you look forward and think about where Famous is going, our family, where we're, you know, trying to, you know, take the company, what are your thoughts about just the future?
Every day, in every way, I have more confidence of how great our future will be. In fact, this girl that I talked to, that I met yesterday, this purchasing agent, out of the blue, she said, you have the best associates of any distributor in Cleveland, and your company has a vision. She brought it up. We have a vision. And every meeting we go to, we talk about what we're going to do to improve, what we're going to do. We need to hire a person here, another person IT, another person HR, another person in marketing. And it's continual improvement. And with the quality of your father, and then I don't want you to get too big ahead, but between you and Brian, there is no one that is blessed with two grandsons that have all the attributes that we needed, and that's a tribute to your mother and your father.
Well, thank you. The it brings up an interesting point, an interesting question. You know, when you think about most family-owned distributors, you know, there's a founder. Maybe they have a couple kids, and maybe those kids have a couple kids, and by the time you get to the second, third, fourth generation, it's a hodgepodge. For us, we've been very different, and obviously it's worked to our benefit. It's been very linear. So when you think about, you know, Hyman, you, my dad, now Brian and I, what would be your advice to Brian and I? How do Brian and I need to work together? Because when it's just one, right, it's easier. There's no, you know, it's ultimately it comes down to you and you making the final decisions. Brian and I are, this is going to be different for our company and our family because he and I are going to have to lead together and really stay aligned and in sync. And it's harder to be aligned as two people than it is as one people. It's harder to get three people aligned. For, so how do Brian and I best stay aligned?
It's the simplest answer. First of all, I think the statistics are that I think only about 2% of customers, 2% of companies last to the fourth generation. Every year it cuts down. You and Brian are blessed because your interests are so different. His interest, I'm not gonna go through it on this thing, but you know how different you both are. When we have our meetings, and sometimes a question would come up to Brian, you could say, let Kevin answer that. He knows much more about the IT or this and that than I do. So you might sometimes have little discussions. I'm not even gonna call it arguments, but at the end, you both agree and you go on, and I've never seen you and Brian have a grudge even when you were little kids. So you don't have a grudge, you respect each other, and you have different things. Like if you get two kids and all they both wanna do is sales, you could have a conflict, or both wanna run the accounting. You could have a conflict, but the two of you have separated what we need to make Famous successful, and you work in your own way, but you collaborate and talk all the time together. So there's no conflict. Mm-hmm. I've never seen or heard Brian say anything negative about you, or you say anything negative about him. You support each other, and that you can't make it phony, and everybody in the company knows it. So instead of just me or instead of your father, our people are blessed with two people at the top.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good perspective. I think from what I took from that and what I'm hearing from that is when you said, you know, you got to agree and move forward. What that makes me think of is like, even if we disagree, we need to agree upon whatever the path is.
Yes.
And then, you know, commit to that. I think it's right. Like an Amazon saying is disagree and commit. Even if you disagree, it doesn't matter. You have to be on board. And
yeah, and the problem is there's so many things the company could do, from where to open up branches, buying this, what new product, that you got to get a consensus of priority and focus on that. And I was pretty good at that. Your dad was great at that. And you two are going to be even better.
Well, thank you.
So I don't worry about Famous.
Cool. So what else do you want to talk about?
Well, I don't know. Your questions are good today. Your inheritance is still going on. I'm not going to change my will.
Thank you.
I'm just proud of our company. I'm proud of every associate. I can't believe the quality of our new ones we brought in. It just amazes me. Everyone has a positive attitude on the future. We're one of, I keep in touch with a lot of my distributor friends around the country that I met on industry trips, and I was an officer in ASA, I was an officer in ACA, I was officer all over. So I met different people. And in 2020, the worst pandemic that ever hit, our sales were up and our profits were up because we didn't worry about that. We went ahead. And I don't know a fraction of distributors that could say that. And in this year, we're blowing away all our other things. So I don't worry about, and in fact, when there's ever been problems in the country, because we've had other recessions and stuff, Famous becomes stronger because we put in more inventory, hire more people. We don't even look backwards. I don't know if I should say this on film, but I'm gonna. The last 15 months, we added $29 million of more inventory into Famous. Everybody else is cutting inventory, doing this, getting rid of people. Your dad had the foresight, and we allowed our people to bring in all these other products that not only made us successful in 2020 and 21, but it's going to be for the next years to come.
What about the Browns? Are we ever going to win a Super Bowl?
Well, in 1945, the Cleveland Rams won the national championship. Cleveland, NFL championship. In 46, they didn't want to compete against the Browns, so they moved to first team to ever move west of the Mississippi in any major sport. Anyway.
St. Louis?
So I've been Browns.
St. Louis?
Well, they went, first they went to L.A., and they moved that team around. But it's amazing. People didn't know it started in Cleveland in the middle 30s.
Who knew?
And so I've been a Browns guy. I used to go to training camps. Some of my best friends in life were Browns players. When Mark was a little kid, right below me was a cornerback. And one day I was complaining about a player gotten beat the week before. He said, "Jay, you think you know football?" He brought back film. He said, "No, this was this guy's. It wasn't Schofter's man. It was this one." So I loved football, learned football, went to training camps, drank with these players, ate dinner with the players. The 64 team was obviously my favorite, the early 60s. Yeah, the Jim. We won the last time we won the championship. Mm-hmm. So I've been struggling with the Browns all these years. And hopefully, it's going to get better. But there's nothing better than going to a Super Bowl. I took your dad to two Super Bowls, one in New Orleans and one in L.A.
I think you guys went to Miami, right?
I went to Miami.
No. Didn't you go to Super Bowl in Miami, too?
Yeah, but I went to a couple of them. Pittsburgh, Dallas, one in Miami. They had a lot of them there.
Classic.
But I didn't take your dad to those, you know, he's going to college and doing this and that, and sometimes he just can't get a ticket. I went to two with the Steelers. If you want to have fun, go with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Those fans have more fun. They're like Cleveland. Mm-hmm. They party, they drink, they wear their shirts and everything. So hopefully I'll see it probably on TV if the Browns win. Mm-hmm. I hope to win that. I'll have to talk to my cardiologist to see if I can live that long.
Maybe you can make the trip down. Yeah, that's another question. Well, Papa, this has been amazing. I know that the people watching, I'm sure, really appreciate it. I just can't tell you how much love and appreciation we, our family, and of course the Famous family. There's so many people that care about you so much because you care about them so much. So I know that this will be a treat for everybody
to
see.
I want to thank you for allowing me to do this. I had no idea what's going to happen. You never told me one question.
Yes.
It's strictly impromptu. And I enjoyed this because what I enjoy is thinking back on all the good stuff that I've lived through, done, etc. So I want to thank you for inviting me on this interview. And it was exciting. You know, I had a little anxiety, but now I'm just excited. I hope I can sleep tonight.
Yeah, well, if you can't, I'm sure you'll be sending out some emails.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Thanks, Pop.
Thank you.